In this video, we're going to talk about the relationship that exists between budget constraints and opportunity costs. A budget constraint is just used to tell us what combinations of a good we can afford to buy with a given income. We're going to take a really simple example where parents provide an elementary school student with some money that can be used to only buy two things, fruit cups or cupcakes, to make the choice really simple. A fruit cup costs $1.50. A cupcake costs $1, and the parents provide this child with $30 a month to buy one or the other, or maybe both. We're going to look at what combination of goods can be purchased over the course of this month, given this income and given these prices. And that's the type of thing that a budget constraint captures. If this child spends all of his income on fruit cups, then he has a total of $30, and each fruit cup costs $1.50. So the most that could be purchased is 20, which we get by just dividing the amount of money the person has to spend, their income in a sense, by the price of the good. So 30 over $1.50 is equal to 20 units. And again, if you buy 20 units of fruit cups at $1.50 each, you spent your entire income of $30. The math gets even easier for cupcakes because since they cost $1 each, the student could choose to buy 30 cupcakes. More generally, though, there are other combinations between these two extremes of buying only one or the other that can also be afforded. We can graph these by just connecting those two points. For example, if the individual chose to spend half of his income on fruit cups, he'd be able to purchase 10 fruit cups, and the other half of income could go to purchase 15 cupcakes. But any point on that line would be feasible. One question you might ask is, how you might buy a fraction of a cupcake to get all those points connected? Well, just remember, this is in a typical month. You can adjust the timing of these things so that you can get fractional components as well. For example, you might not be able to buy 2/3 of a fruit cup in a given day, but you could choose to buy 2 fruit cups and spread the consumption of that over 3 days so that each day you're consuming 2/3 of a fruit cup, for example. Even more generally, though, let's just consider some general goods represented by the variables X and Y, where X is a quantity of good X, Y is a quantity of good Y. We're going to define the price of good X as PX, the price of good Y as PY, and income by the letter I. In this case, our budget constraint becomes PX times X, which is the expenditure on X, plus PY times Y, which is the expenditure on Y, must add up to total income. For simplicity, we're not going to allow for either borrowing or lending. All of this analysis applies just as well when we have any number of goods, multiple time periods, and the possibilities of borrowing or lending. The analysis just becomes more complicated. The basic principles can be illustrated with a simple two-good case. The relationship that would exist involves the same type of analysis as in our example before with the fruit cups and the cupcakes. If all the income is spent on good Y, the amount that could be purchased is computed in exactly the same way as income divided by the price of Y. If all the spending is devoted to buying good X, then the total amount that could be purchased would equal income divided by the price of X. And all the points in between represent different combinations of X and Y that this individual can buy given these prices and given this level of income. Now, if we want to measure the slope of this relationship, we still have the same definitions. And one thing we can use is that slope-intercept formula that we talked about in an earlier video, where we know if we solve for y, we can get the relationship in the form y equals mx plus b, where the coefficient multiplying x, the m coefficient, will be the slope, and that b, that constant term, will be the intercept on the vertical axis, which we already know. Let's solve for that. We take the budget constraint, PXX plus PYY equals I, and we want to simplify that to solve it for Y. We can do that first by getting rid of the term involving X on the left-hand side by subtracting that from both sides. So now we have PY times Y equals negative PX times X plus I. The last step here in simplifying for Y is just dividing both sides through by PY. And when we do that, we end up with y is equal to the negative of the ratio of the price of good x to the price of good y times X plus income divided by the price of good Y. So we now have it in the slope-intercept form where Y equals MX plus B. The slope, or that M term, is equal to the negative of the price of good X over the price of good Y, which we can just note will always be, in this too good case, the ratio of the negative of the price of the good on the horizontal axis divided by the price of the good on the vertical axis. The intercept matches what we've already computed, which is income over the price of good Y on the vertical axis. And we already have established, again, the intercept on the horizontal axis. So that all matches up quite nicely. But the slope also has another interesting interpretation. The slope, by definition of a linear relationship, is defined to be the change in Y over the change in X. But that's essentially nothing more than the opportunity cost of one unit of X in terms of foregone units of Y. It tells you the rate at which Y has to change when X changes by one unit. So what this is telling us is that the opportunity cost of buying one more unit of good X is that we give up an amount of Y equal to the negative of the ratio of the price of good X to the price of good Y. If we take that example we worked through earlier, we know that the slope of this relationship will be equal to the price of good X, the good on the horizontal axis, which we've established is 1, divided by the price of the good on the vertical axis, which in this case is fruit cups at a price of $1.50. So the slope of that will equal a negative 1 over 150, or just 2/3. And what that's telling us is that the opportunity cost of one cupcake is that we give up 2/3 of a fruit cup. And you can see with a little bit of logic that is correct, because if you spend $1 on a cupcake, you've given up 2/3 of the price of buying a fruit cup. If we want to measure the opportunity cost in the other direction, the opportunity cost of a fruit cup in terms of a cupcake, it's just going to be the reciprocal of that, or 1.5. Because if we purchase one fruit cup, we've given up $1.50, which would be equivalent to what could have been used to purchase 1.5 cupcakes.